Hi, I'm Paul Vunak. Welcome to Trapping. What I'd like to attempt in this video is to teach us how to do some of the Wing Chun traps out of the matrix of boxing. Doing Wing Chun out of Wing Chun from a reference point is one thing, but doing it out of boxing where somebody's trying to stick a jab in your face and you have to worry about eating that leather and actually having the timing to come in for that pak sao, that's something a little bit different. So what we want to do is we're going to show you the very basic move, but again, we're going to be doing it out of the matrix of boxing. Okay, Singh, could I borrow you, please? First and foremost, when I'm in an altercation with somebody, we're moving around, I get up in my stance, and that is more like a Thai boxer. Down here is Western boxing. I give that a B. Down here is karate. That lowers us down to a C minus. Up here is more Thai boxing, A plus, for what we do. So we assume the A plus Thai boxer stance. When the jab comes in, we're moving around, we just lean back a little bit. That's the first and best thing you should always do against a jab. Okay, so Singh, we're moving around, boom, I flip out of the way, maybe a little pat, boom, boom. And whoop, pop, that's the pak sao, okay? So when I want, we're moving around, slip that jab, boom, grunting occasionally, whoop, pop, and that's the pak sao. So to do this real slow, the jab comes out, I slip, I come back, boom. Again, slip, come back, and that's the move. All right, everybody, come on out. I'd like you to see everybody. Give this a try. Ready, and go. And break. Congratulations, you just enrolled in a very small membership club. One of the few people that can actually do a functional pak sao. Most people do Wing Chun moves from a static position. We teach that in seminars because you gotta start somewhere, but eventually you have to get past that static position into the world of functional. What that means is you gotta be able to do this stuff against a guy really trying to hit you, gloved up and really trying to hit you. All right, so now that we've got our pak sao out of the way, we're gonna move on to the next trap. The block that the opponent could do after he throws the jab and you pak sao him is to block with this hand. We call this hand wu sao, the rear hand. If that occurs, we're gonna do a lop sao. Okay, Singh, if I could borrow you. You're gonna probably be used to seeing this move something like this, okay? Well, that's cool, but that and a quarter will get you a cup of coffee. okay? Because you've got to go past that and take it up to the point to where this guy's actually trying to hit you if you want to make a paksao functional. So now we're moving around again. He's throwing the jab. I slip out of the way. I pock. But as he blocks with his hand, I'm feeling the pressure a little bit this way. I come to a lop sao. And this is my next position. So I want you to be out moving around like a boxer. But then I want you to end up stopped right here like a Wing Chun man. Okay, so let's watch our crowd again. See how everybody does it. That'll give you a feel. And then we'll let you give it a try. Everybody come on out. And begin. Before we move to our next point, I have to bring out a principle with you. I need you to pay attention. This is perhaps one of the most important things you're going to hear me say on the physical plane. If the opponent gets close enough to hit you, you do not just stand there. You don't start a fight in a range where both of you can hit each other. People do, but that's called a sport. That's boxing, kickboxing, even MMA folks. Everybody starts so close, they can already hit each other. If that is the case, none of this will work. You have to start from the energy, the canvas of the picture that we're painting has to be intercepting this person. So you're always moving around, always backing up, kind of like Sugar Ray Leonard used to, or if you remember Muhammad Ali, they just had this proclivity to always back up, back up. When that happens, that forces your opponent to encroach. We used to watch hours and hours of Bruce Lee spar. Larry Hartzell and Dan Anasano and myself and Chris Kent. And we'd be up until 2 in the morning with those 8mm movies. And I can still smell the film. And we would just watch Bruce over and over. And he always did the same thing. And funny, he never wrote about this stuff. But he always backed up when he sparred. He got all of his opponents to chase him. And then when he was out in such a long range that nobody could hit anybody, if he wanted to hit you, he developed a shuffle, and that shuffle, he could come in and hit you and get way back out again. On the other hand, the opponent didn't have that shuffle, so the opponent has to encroach, and therefore they would get intercepted. So this is how intercepting comes to play. You can't intercept if you're close enough that you can both hit each other. So come on in here, close enough we can both hit each other. Okay, now if we're sparring from here, boom, 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 there's no intercepting, there's just trading. The bigger guy is going to win. On the other hand, if I start in the range that I prescribe to everybody, and that's we're out here, Now, when he comes in, boom, I can kick the groin on the way in. I would never let this man slowly encroach, and then throw punches or maybe kicks. And you don't know what he's going to throw here because he's here. There's no way I would have, unless I have a crystal ball. So when I intercept, I'm not intercepting a strike. I'm intercepting his entire body encroaching on me. So with my hand up here, if I miss it and it comes flying in quick, bam, that's going to end up right there on him. But most likely I won't. I see him coming in, boom, and that's going to be an interception just when he gets close enough. So this drill will not work if you're both in this range. Just stand there, please. If you're both in this range, just standing here, this drill won't work. You have to be out here, okay? So in this next round, we're going to watch everybody do the move, but as one person encroaches a little bit, in addition to the paksao, they're going to do a shuffle kick right to the old groin. Okay, everybody come on out. Ready. Now we do the paksao and the interception to the groin. Go. See if you can pick out the interceptions in the class. Now for our next move, we're going to give you a scenario by which you're fighting a boxer who's tall and he's sticking a jab in your face. And when that occurs, one of my favorite moves, assuming we have our hands up the way they should be, is that you lower your elevation and you slap his groin. One slap is worth 5 kicks. When you hit an organ, the energy disperses, whether you're hitting the kidney or the solar plexus or slapping the groin even. Okay, so George, come on out. So George is the boxer. He's got his hands up. He's moving around. I want to have this anyway. This is typically how I deal with that jab. Boom. Okay. But maybe he's really tall. He comes in, wham, and I hit the groin. Okay. So again, we're moving around, and that's the groin shot. When you slap a nice shot, just ever so ascending in the angle, try to keep your fingers together and your wrist loose. And you'll get the biggest bang for your buck. Other guy, jab. Forget the going shot, occasional kick. and break. Now I'd like to show you what a palm slap can do, generating the umph. So we're gonna hit a glove. Does somebody have a, no, not that one, that's a Neverlast. Give me a century. Okay, good. All right, come on up. All right, so what we're gonna do, we'll have the glove right here, representing the groin, okay? I want you to just keep your wrist really loose and your hand cupped, okay? Fingers have to be together, it's real important, okay? Because the shock will disperse if the fingers are not together. So we get down loose, we get down low, and this is the mechanics, voo. And then right when I'm here, okay? Didn't take much for the groin, that's a little bit of overkill. So if your hands are up, forget the glove now, just don't move. And whoosh, okay? So it doesn't really matter if you're hitting a 6'5" Samoan or a 5'6" librarian, okay? If you slap them both in the balls like that, they're gonna both go down exactly the same way. So what we wanna try to do is make as many of our techniques render size and strength a moot point. And the best way I know to do that is to attack the eyes, the groin, and to bite. These are the, well, and headbutts are good too. These are the best moves in life to render size and strength a moot point. Stay with me. Now on our next move, we're dancing around out in long range. We're dealing with that boxer. He's got a good jab, a real tall guy, and the groin just seems to be right here. So you go for it, you lower down, and you slap it. Occasionally when that happens, you're gonna receive a block, okay? It's either gonna be with the front or the rear hand. Okay, Anshu, come on in. Okay, let's get you to tack in at this angle, and I'm gonna come down low. This is gonna be the front hand block. So I'm trying to swat at the groin and she's gonna boom, that's the block. Okay, so right, boom, right here. And at that moment I'm here, boom, that's my guachoy, pin choy guachoy. So one more time, boom, boom. Boom, boom. If you notice when her hands are up, There is no opening to get to the face. When I shoot my hand low, if her front hand blocks real slow, that opens up the right side of her face. Back, please. Now, if her left hand blocks, I'll get you on this angle. That's going to open up the left side of the face. Put it back again. So therefore, when I go with my shot, if I get this block, we're going to go this way. Okay, so one more time, boom, boom. And one more time at this angle, boom, boom. Okay, and what am I aiming for? One, going for the groin, she blocks that. I trap, don't move, don't block it. Boop, right in the eyes. Let's give it a try. Switch feeder. Don't forget the occasional kick to the groin.
Nice.
now, to continue the way we've been doing things, I'm going to pull out a couple of my seniors and I want you to watch them move. Why do we do this? This is the most important part of the tape. You can watch me stand here and do a technique for you, okay? But if you don't know what that technique is supposed to look like when it's trained, actually trained, it's gonna be difficult for you. So you need to see a few points, whether you need to write these down or just keep a mental note. Number one, they're both out in long range. They don't start, you will never see any of my guys starting in a range where they can both hit each other because you can't intercept, so you're not doing JKD, okay? So they both start in a long range. Then what you're gonna see is perpetual movement, faking low, but then when the actual shot is blocked, this boxing stuff goes out the window and the new art is substituted Wing Chun. The actual move we're doing is called a pin choi gua choi, if you are interested in that, okay? And then Singh's job is going to be to feel that energy of Hector's rear hand, which we call Wu Sao, and to ascertain if it's a Pak Sao or a Lap Sao, okay? So you're gonna watch the energy, you're gonna watch the movement, and I want you to imitate how they do it. All right, gents, come on out. We're gonna start off real slow and build speed and get nice and close and then go from there. Sometimes a rear hand block. Yes. Work toward the center, boys. Back up thing. Beautiful. Stay there. Back up thing a little bit. Beautiful. And break. Now, if you'll notice, when they were moving around, every time Hector got a little too close for Singh, he couldn't help but to resist to put in Tai Chi. It's almost like we can't not do it, because we flow from art to art to art. This is a very basic tape. We want to give you the fundamentals. If you can't do your stuff out of boxing, you can't get to first base in the world of trapping, okay? So we have to kind of get you off the ground with that, okay? So again, the most important thing that you guys are going to get is not the actual technique, but how we do it, okay? Watch the energy. Right, we're about 3/4 of the way through and we're almost up to the termination part of our trapping game. We use Wing Chun to trap the hands up, but we find that the typical Jeet Kune Do straight blast isn't a powerful enough tool to take out the heavyweights. So we want to shift again from Wing Chun now into the world of Thai boxing. So we've shifted from the Western boxer moving around, we kick into the Wing Chun man, we go back to the Wing Chun man again, and then we become the Thai boxer. And we come up and we clinch the neck. The neck clinch is one of my favorite moves in the world. everything good in life comes from a neck clinch, okay? You leaping face bite, you can take off the nose, you can put somebody to sleep gently without a scratch on their face. You can take them down to the ground. You can headbutt, you can knee, you can elbow. The Thais really, really knew their game when they developed the neck clinch. And then when we put in the thumbs to the eyes and the knee to the groin, this becomes one of the most viable reference points in a fight. And if you can get into this neck clinch from your Wing Chun trapping, pop, pop, and then you're here already, it's a much, much more sophisticated way to get to that clinch as opposed to just punching it out like Rocky and then reaching out and grabbing it. So what you're gonna see, Singh, come on out. We're moving around. We're gonna go kind of slow. Again, it's that pox out. So he's throwing that jab, boom, boom. Boom, pop. But when we get to here, then I do the lop sao, and then I'm going to come up to the neck clinch. And this is my clinch right here. When I get the neck clinch, that's when we come with the heavy tools. Okay? So again, slowly, we're moving around. Boom. 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 Boom, pop. Boom. And then we stop right here. All right, gents? Let's give it a try. Now we're right up to the neck clinch. This is my favorite move. I've been telling you guys about this neck clinch since 1978. Okay, this is the termination phase of our rat. We borrowed this from Thai boxers. When the Thai boxer has his hands wrapped around your neck and he's moving you around, there is nothing you can do. It is the worst feeling. You might think, oh, I'll poke him in the eye. Right, I'll kick him in the groin. Not when you have no base. When you're a leaf in the wind and he's moving you around, really move me around this one, the first round. Really move me around. Okay, so you go, yeah. So now watch what happens when I just put a hand up. Just a hand, and then I can put my other hand up, and now I have my base. Now I can do the real nasty stuff because I have a base. Everything will work. So the counter to this neck clinch is to reach up and grab his neck. Once you grab his neck, then come up with the other hand and grab it, now you'll be the guy in the middle. But if he knows that, he's going to do the same thing. So we're going to have this energy type drill. Okay, so George, thing, let's take it from long range. We're going to move around, come in with that pocket lop, and go. Now they're in the clinch. Separate again. Same thing one more time. George, you come in. Paksal lapsal. There, he got his base, and now they're back and forth with it. And break. Beautiful, guys. Now, if you notice, and I want you to watch this round in slow motion many times, whoever has the other guy's neck, just watch his feet, and they're flying around until this guy gets his hand up, and then everybody bases out. It's like you just stopped the ship from rocking, and then you can do what you want. And interesting enough, watch how many MMA folks don't know that. Because MMA are the greatest fighters in the world. Make no bones about it. And they've borrowed from Thai boxing, mainly, and they've borrowed from Brazilian jiu-jitsu. They've borrowed from many arts, okay? But those are the main arts. The problem is, when they borrowed from Thai boxing, they got the offense, but they didn't get the nuances. When they borrowed from Brazilian jiu-jitsu, they got up to about a purple belt, most of them. Not the world champions, of course, but most of them, okay? So what we want to do is we want to get the nuances of each. We want to be a black belt on the ground. We want to really understand the Thai boxing. And we want our boxing hands to be a Western boxer, like a pro boxer. This is the formula that we want. Okay, guys, one more time. We're going to come up. We're going to pummel. We're going to go to the neck. But this time, from the neck, we're going to go for a body clinch. And we're going to get into a pummel from there. Yes, the good old pummel that we know. Okay, come on up. We're moving around nice and slow, real slow this round. Good. Real slow, real slow. Now we're at the neck. Now we go to the body. Now he's going to the body. Now we're into the pummel. No strikes yet, just pummel. And trying to outbase each other a little bit. Now, sing headbutts and knees. And then pummel, boom. George, headbutts and knees. George, eye gouge. Sing, go to the tie neck. And break. Beautiful, boys. Okay. So what we've got now is we have boxing movement. We have the Wing Chun. We have the Thai boxing, we have the Kali, and we have the Tai Chi. You put all this together, this is contemporary Jeet Kune Do. Stick with me. Well, I hope you enjoyed our trapping tape. In my opinion, trapping is the epicenter of Jeet Kune Do. It's the essential element that differentiated Bruce from other people. And in the world of Jeet Kune Do, there are folks that learned Jeet Kune Do in the 60s, and that's one type of Jeet Kune Do. When Bruce passed away, the art left with Bruce. The main thing that that man left us with was the principle that his art has to keep growing. The very certificate that is on the wall of every one of the people in original Jeet Kune Do and every one of the students under Dan and Asano says that my students have the right to change because change is necessary to adapt to the ever-changing conditions of life. So the goal in Jeet Kune Do is to continue progressing. Well, we have progressed in combat. We've progressed in our Jeet Kune Do at the Kali Academy under Dan and Asano. Our Jeet Kune Do since 1985 has been Wing Chun mixed with Thai boxing. And then from the Thai boxing, we go into the elbows, the knees, and the headbutts. So the Thai boxing aspect with the Wing Chun aspect constitutes the stand-up game of Jeet Kune Do. In 1985, we met the Gracies. They came into our family, and the Jeet Kune Do family and the Gracie family got like this. And when that happened, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu entered into the matrix of our modern Jeet Kune Do. As of 1986, our Jeet Kune Do at our academy looked like Thai boxing on the stand-up, a little bit of Wing Chun, hardcore, and ground fighting Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. So that is MMA to this day. 95% of MMA lies within the world of Thai boxing and Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. This is contemporary Jeet Kune Do. Mixed martial artist rose to the highest level in the world of fighting, and they came to this level, and the Jeet Kune Do people, and they both met at the top of the mountain, and they have the same art. So what we are practicing now are Thai boxing, our Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, and the Wing Chun trapping that you just got through working in this tape. When you put all that together, you have contemporary Jeet Kune Do. Randy Couture named a funny expression. He calls boxing when you clinch and punch, he calls it dirty boxing. And so we like to think of our MMA as filthy MMA. So I'm going to leave you thinking about that note. Good luck and God bless.
Kickboxing! Kickboxing! Clinch, tie up! Hit the ground, jujitsu, my friend. Some of you stay on your feet, some of you stay on the ground. Okay, work your way up, grab the knife.